Released by THQ in 2006, The Outfit for the Xbox 360 is a unique take on the World War II shooter, a genre which proliferated during the era of its release. It attempted to mash up genres, one of which the game's developer was very well known for, in order to stand out from the sea of otherwise similar games, but was beset with delays as well as issues after the fact. Is it an unsung hero of the battlefield deserving of a medal, or should it be court-martialed for dereliction of duty? This is Chris from MakoPowered, and welcome to Weekend Rental, where we look at games that, while not widely considered classics, or sometimes even good, are still worth examining and maybe even playing despite themselves. So, full disclosure, this video came about because of a discussion I was having with Rob over at Sweaty Couch. We were discussing the game's unique approach to the World War II shooter genre, and the historical events it gets right, and wrong. Moreover, this video literally couldn't have existed without him for a couple of reasons. This game wasn't even on my radar before our conversation because of the aforementioned deluge of mid-aughts World War II shooters, which I have largely tried to avoid. I'm interested in the early Medal of Honor games because of their historical importance and approach to the subject, but I'm pretty okay skipping all of the also-ran games. Because of that, I wouldn't have discovered The Outfit without him. Also, my capture card died while trying to record my run through the game, and while I did play through the game myself, he generously provided footage of his playthrough in order to get the video made. So, huge shout out to Rob. Thank you. And if you're watching this and haven't checked out his channel here on YouTube yet, here's the link in the corner of the screen. Getting back to the game itself, while it was published by THQ, and how is it that we haven't covered a THQ game on Weekend Rental before now? It was not developed in-house. Instead, The Outfit's unique blend of gameplay was put together by Relic Entertainment. Talking about this with Rob, this gave me hope for the game before I played it. Relic has, quite the back catalog. They're responsible for the outstanding Homeworld games, the Warhammer 40k Dawn of War series, the Company of Heroes games, and even the fourth entry in the Age of Empires franchise, only just released in 2021. That's an impressive pedigree, and I personally love the Homeworld series. So that's cause for excitement, right? Well, here's the thing. If you stop and take a look at Relic's output, it consists almost entirely of strategy games. The only dedicated shooter they released, arguably aside from The Outfit, we'll get to why The Outfit's debatable in a minute, is 2011's Warhammer 40k Space Marine. Not to be confused with the earlier Kuju-developed first-person shooter Fire Warrior, Space Marine is a squad-based, third-person perspective cover-based shooter featuring massive soldiers in ruined environments. Let's just be nice and say that it is a, touching homage to the Gears of War franchise. Okay, that's not entirely fair. The melee combat is significantly more nuanced here. Anyway, the point is that, while Space Marine was generally well-received, it was released a good 5 years after The Outfit, and there were clearly lessons learned from the earlier game's development. This is not to say that The Outfit doesn't do interesting things with its gameplay, it's just that Relic's prior experience being only strategy games shows through strongly here. Very strongly. In fact, that's kind of the point of the gameplay. While the game was marketed as a shooter, even during a 2006 IGN developer interview with lead designer Jeff Brown, who describes it as just a
squad-based, third-person action game.
That's not really how the game plays. Sure, the player controls one of three main characters, who we will definitely be discussing in a moment, from an over-the-shoulder third-person perspective, and yes, the player can engage directly in gunplay using any of these characters. That's not the core of the gameplay loop, however. Instead, Relic's pedigree shows through in spades. This is, for all intents and purposes, a real-time strategy game. Just a real-time strategy game controlled from a third-person, over-the-shoulder perspective. The so-called destruction-on-demand mechanic that the game's publicity touts so highly is straight-up just a real-time strategy unit generation mechanic. They literally show you the core unit menu on the back of the box. At any time, as long as you have sufficient funds, you can generate vehicles, squad members, and artillery cannons, and place them on the field within range of your chosen hero character. Well, okay. Less place and more airdrop. This is an important distinction that we'll circle around to. It's a really cool idea and really separates the game from its contemporaries, but the whole experience reminded me heavily of another game that tried a similar approach a few years later, 2009's Brutal Legend. Both games were character-driven, third-person, over-the-shoulder perspective real-time strategy games. Both games were largely marketed as something they really weren't. The Outfit is a generic, if tongue-in-cheek, World War II shooter, Brutal Legend as a God of War-style combat game. The main difference is the level of polish in the games themselves. What I mean is that, much like Relic with Space Marine, Double Fine seems to have learned from some of the mistakes made by The Outfit with Brutal Legend. See, there are some quirks to The Outfit's gameplay, both the shooting and the real-time strategy, which make the game more of a chore to play than one would expect. For one thing, none of the actual gunplay, on foot or in a vehicle, feels particularly good to control, which, I suspect, is a result of Relic's inexperience with that sort of gameplay style. The devs took the common notion of movement or rapid fire affecting your aim, signified by an expanding and contracting targeting reticule, from the multitude of other shooters out there. Okay, fine, fair enough, that makes obvious sense. The thing is that, even standing still, none of the guns feels particularly accurate, not even J.D. Tyler's sniper rifle. It honestly feels like there's an XCOM-like hit percentage system working behind the scenes, so that, no matter how good your aim is, there's still a chance you can miss your shots. The only exception that I was able to determine was Max Flamethrower, which is a good area of effect attack, but you sacrifice range, which comes with its own issues. This gets even worse when piloting a vehicle. The spray from any of the mounted machine guns means that you can aim at an enemy unit standing feet away from the vehicle and still largely miss. The weird thing is that the same can be said for trying to run over the on-foot enemies. They seem to have spider sense or superhuman reflexes, because 19 times out of 20, no matter how fast you're going or how little room there is to do so, they will dodge your efforts to run them over. This may seem sadistic, but when your team is on the line and you're waiting for your gun's cooldown meter, another RTS mechanic that all of the guns have, this tactic would seem like a good alternative, but nope. What makes this all the weirder is the fact that you, as a player, do not have the same safeguard from your own vehicles. This goes back to the distinction between placing units and having them airdropped in. You can absolutely have your hero character killed by a vehicle you yourself called in because you're standing in the drop zone. You'd figure there would be some sort of safeguard preventing this, especially considering there seems to be one for the enemy units, but, well, here we are. You can legit drop a tank on your own head and have to wait to... well, you'll see. First though, we need to discuss the overall driving in the game, because it feels floaty and hard to aim, no matter which vehicle you find yourself in. Kind of like a cross between the vehicle control in Halo and the Mako tank in the first Mass Effect. Even driving a tank doesn't feel as weighty as it should. Slow does not necessarily equate with weight. Not to mention there is also an awkward, what do we want to call it? I'm not sure if it's a glitch or intentional, so idiosyncrasy with the vehicles, where they can all drive up near vertical terrain, like the Mass Effect Mako tank, except here, they can get stuck on that vertical terrain. When this happens, the player has no choice but to abandon the vehicle, call in another one, and then destroy the stuck one so the enemy can't commandeer it. On that note, while the game boasts that everything explodes, there are some weird caveats to that. The most glaring is the way on-foot enemy soldiers react to artillery shells from cannons and tanks. Or perhaps not react would be a better way to put it. See, if you hit an enemy foot soldier directly with an artillery shell, they hilariously disintegrate into uniform meat chunks a la early Mortal Kombat, which, again, okay, fine, fair enough, it's over the top enough to be funny. However, if you miss even slightly and explode a shell right beside a unit, or even a group of units, they will be knocked onto their backs for a couple of moments, before getting right back up and continuing their assault, apparently completely shrugging off the explosion that occurred right in front of them. It makes playing as Deuce Williams particularly frustrating, because his default weapon is a bazooka. It's great for fighting tanks and artillery emplacements on foot when you run out of funds, but makes fighting other troops far more difficult than it should be. Which brings me to the currency system, which I both love and hate. Unlike most RTS games, the currency for the game, called Field Units, or FUs, which, come on, that acronym has to have been an intentional decision, is not generated from particular allied buildings or units as in other RTSs. Instead, your available FUs are based on the amount of destruction you cause. specifically the number of enemy soldiers, artillery, and vehicles you take out along the way. On the one hand, this is a good workaround considering the game's focus on a hero character for the player rather than the standard zoomed out overhead perspective of most RTS games. You don't need to worry about establishing a mining camp or whatever, just keep fighting and taking out threats. On the other hand, because of the way the game handles deaths and respawning, you can absolutely be left in near unwinnable situations. For example, needing to fight a heavily armored tank, but not having the FUs to bring in sufficient armament or soldiers to do so, meaning that you're stuck doing it by yourself on foot. Speaking of, let's talk about the death and respawning mechanic, because it is also an interesting approach, especially in the single player portion of the game. The outfit doesn't have a traditional lives system, or even a regular checkpoint system as such. Instead, when the game says that you will respawn in 5 seconds, it means exactly that. You respawn at the last Axis building you took over, with the game keeping track of everything right up until the point you died and not resetting anything. This means that enemies you've already defeated stay defeated, units you've placed on the map stay on the map, vehicles that were destroyed before your demise remain destroyed. In other words, it treats your avatar in single player like it's in the middle of a multiplayer match. As mentioned, this can affect the player's currency count and lead to awkward scenarios because destroyed enemies, vehicles, and artillery do not respawn, meaning you cannot build up the FUs you would have gotten from defeating them again. I'm not entirely sure why the devs went with this setup. While it's certainly novel, it's just not necessarily in a good way. Oh, right, I had mentioned taking over enemy buildings. Let me explain, because that is another unique RTS-like aspect of the game, and another aspect that can lead to frustration thanks to the whole respawn mechanic. In each level, there is an armory, a radio tower, and a motor pool, and the player needs to capture all three of them from the enemy, which has two effects. First, it's a win condition for each mission. You have to do it to progress. Second, these buildings control which units you can call in using the Destruction on Demand menu. In other words, if, for example, you want to use a tank to get through a level, and you really do want to use a tank, you need to make sure to capture and hold the armory. I say and hold because just as you can capture these buildings from the Axis forces, they can recapture them from you. This can get frustrating if you're stuck in a particularly difficult portion of the game. Remember how I said that the game doesn't reset anything when you die and respawn? This includes enemy troops moving to take back these buildings. This can make these difficult areas even more difficult, because you can suddenly find yourself without access to your most powerful units and vehicles if this happens. This gameplay loop of capturing these three buildings is honestly the main drive of each level, which, when combined with the fact that you can lose these buildings while waiting to respawn, is a huge contributor to the game feeling like a drawn-out slog. Sure, there are other objectives in the missions, but most of them are optional. You need to capture those same three buildings each time in each level. Now, this wouldn't be an issue if the maps were imaginatively designed. I mean, a lot of RTS games face a similar challenge when the basic goals are essentially the same from mission to mission. With that in mind, a lot of RTS maps also offer a variety of terrain layouts and ways to approach them. In other words, they're fairly open, and therefore open-ended in terms of how to tackle them. Here though, while it does feel like the developers were trying to combine the open-ended feel of RTS maps with the more restrictive nature of third-person shooter levels of the day, it didn't exactly come together properly. There are areas that do open up, sure, but the majority of the maps are fairly constrained corridors that the player is forced down, basically guided from one objective to the next. Because of this map design, the actual strategy element of the game becomes kind of limited, as you can confidently just use the corridor structure as a funnel point for enemies. Having said that, it also feels constricting because the zoomed out perspective used whenever the player is in a vehicle, which is going to be about 90% of the time, shows the possibilities present if the maps had been opened up more, and there is a frustration to the handholding that's going on. It honestly feels like the focus was on multiplayer over single player. A notion that's perhaps borne out by the fact that THQ released the multiplayer as a standalone Xbox Live Arcade download ahead of the game's full release. The thing is that I was unable to test the multiplayer because the outfit is essentially an Xbox 360 launch title released in 2006 by pre-bankruptcy THQ. It would honestly be a minor miracle if the servers were still up for it in 2023. That doesn't mean that you can't get a sense for what the multiplayer was like. Trailers, the manual, and YouTube videos all give an adequate feeling for... Wait. Wait. Did the multiplayer allow one of the participants to play as the Nazis? Like, over-the-shoulder perspective, jackboots on the ground Nazis? What in the holy hell? Who thought this was a good idea? THQ Nordic's 8chan AMA takes on a whole new dimension in this context. This is also explainable, though, by the stance that the outfit takes in regard to the makeup of the German army, which becomes abundantly clear in the single-player campaign. In order to discuss it, however, spoiler alert of sorts, because we will be talking about the game's story in detail. I'll get into why I say of sorts in a little bit. First, though, let's address the whole Axis sympathizer thing going on here, because it's a little more complicated than the multiplayer makes it seem. Oh, yeah. There's also going to be a bit of a history lesson along the way as well, but it's necessary, so buckle up. Alright, so at the start of the game, the player is tasked with finding a mysterious German officer who has been terrorizing the French countryside. After the first mission, our heroes come across a local priest who points them in the direction of General Hans von Beck, a Wehrmacht officer who was, as the manual puts it, born into privilege, raised like nobility. As the game and the story progress, the player comes to learn that von Beck is not the terror they were led to believe. That was a misdirect by the priest, who is actually a Nazi collaborator. Instead, the real villain is SS officer General Victor Morder, who is a handlebar mustache away from being a Snidely Whiplash-esque caricature of a villain. Von Beck, while a staunch German patriot, is also a staunch opponent of the Nazi ideology. In fact, von Beck is so opposed to Nazism that the game places him as one of the conspirators in the failed Operation Valkyrie conspiracy. You know, the one where the goal was to blow up Hitler with a suitcase bomb? They made a movie about it starring Tom Cruise. Which, okay, let's take a second to discuss that because there is a lot going on there. First, the game does not represent the actual attempt on Hitler's life accurately at all. You know what though? That's fine. I'm fine with that. The game is going for a pulpy tone, and not being entirely historically accurate is in keeping with that, so okay, no problem there. What I do find odd is that the game's von Beck seems like he is actually modeled after not one, but two of the real-world figures tied to the assassination attempt. First, there's a German field officer named Fedor von Bock. The issue is that the real von Bock was not actually one of the conspirators. It seems that his personality and actions were divided between the game's von Beck and Morder. For instance, the whole burning a church with women and children thing at the end of the first mission, that comes from von Bock telling his troops to burn entire Polish villages if shot at, and if, quote unquote, it proves impossible to identify the house from which the shots came. The real world von Bock openly disagreed with Hitler, sure, but he was allowed that privilege because of how successful he was in his campaigns for the regime. Until he was sent to the Soviet front, which, if you don't know how that went, let's just say the German push got frozen in its tracks. However, the other real-world figure von Beck appears to be modeled after was one of the Operation Valkyrie conspirators, General Ludwig Beck. Beck was chief of the general staff of the German Army High Command, and was, like von Beck in the game, a staunch German patriot. While he supported Hitler's denunciation of the Versailles Treaty, he never officially joined the Nazi Party, and instead became a key player in the conspiracy to assassinate Hitler. Here's the thing with Beck, though. He also didn't serve under the German army during World War II, resigning his commission in August 1938. This didn't mean he didn't want to go to war. He absolutely still wanted to invade neighboring countries. He just disagreed with going to war in 1938, and wanted to assassinate Hitler in order to negotiate to hold on to as much captured territory as possible. So, yeah. Still not a great guy, even if he did try to kill Hitler. Back to the divide between von Beck and Morder in the game, though, this split hints at the stance the game takes in regard to the German army. In fact, Deuce, the eponymous outfit's CO, basically lays it out when he says,
"Okay, listen up. There are two major fighting groups in the German army, Wehrmacht and SS. General Hans von Beck commands the Wehrmacht. Even though they fight under the same flag, the Wehrmacht and SS don't exactly see eye to eye.
So there's rivalry between them?"
"Yep. Could be a good thing for us."
This notion is what is referred to as the myth of the clean Wehrmacht. Essentially, it argues that while the Wehrmacht and SS were both fighting under the German flag, the SS were actual Nazis firmly aligned with Hitler and responsible for the regime's atrocities. The Wehrmacht, on the other hand, were simply either fighting for their country or being forced to fight and actually oppose the actions of the Nazi Party, opposing Hitler but unable to do anything about it. This is inaccurate, to put it mildly. Sure, there were Wehrmacht soldiers and commanders who did feel that way. The Operation Valkyrie conspirators were largely Wehrmacht officers, but this broad generalization offers a false binary between divisions of the German forces. Keep in mind that the Wehrmacht's chain of command led to Hitler himself, and not in a symbolic way like with FDR. Hitler held military rank with the Wehrmacht and issued direct orders. In other words, the Wehrmacht was under his direct control, and it was not the divided house the game makes it out to be. It is kind of understandable that the developers would buy into this myth, however, as it is fairly commonplace in popular culture surrounding World War II. Perhaps most famously, there's Wolfgang Petersen's Das Boot, but also movies like Valkyrie, U-571, and even something like Band of Brothers. The game clearly illustrates this stance as well, not only in the cutscene we just looked at, but also via gameplay. During the 7th mission, for example, one of the optional objectives is to rescue a group of Wehrmacht soldiers from an SS-led firing squad before they're executed. This is why, once it's revealed that Von Beck was part of the assassination plot, and after Deuce is killed, we'll get to that in a moment, Von Beck joins up with the outfit, and the player can actually take control of him in the single-player campaign and lead Wehrmacht forces against the SS enemies. In multiplayer, however, you can still play as the SS officers, so, you know, still not great. However, considering the writer for the game, Paris Qualls, is a black man, it's probably pretty safe to say that there isn't any actual Nazi sympathizing going on here. We'd need to wait for Deep Silver for that, am I right? Speaking of Qualls, though, we need to talk about the game's writing because, how can I put this? It's hit or miss? For one thing, you can see each beat of the story coming from a mile off, which is why the spoiler alert earlier was of sorts. From the traitorous priest, to Mac falling for the French resistance contact, to Von Beck joining up with the Allies, all of it is painfully predictable. For another, the tone in the cutscenes is inconsistent and shifts wildly from moment to moment. The overall game is going for a less serious, pulpy vibe, as mentioned earlier, and again, I don't have a problem with that. It's a nice contrast to the other World War II shooters out there, which carry themselves with perhaps too much gravitas. However, the game will go from, say, a high-energy action sequence involving a tank chase to the aforementioned burned-out church with dead women and children. The church isn't just mentioned in passing either. The player is shown the smoldering remains, including charred corpses and scorched children's toys. It feels like either Qualls or the devs were uncertain that the more irreverent tone would be fully accepted, and threw in moments like this to emphasize the horrors of war. A direct contrast for the tone they claimed to be looking for. This shifting tone is odd considering Qualls' prior work. He's written for shows such as Quantum Leap and Lois and Clark during their strongest seasons, along with penning a Rosa Parks biopic. Because of that, I do have to wonder how much freedom Qualls was given in his writing for the game. This uncertainty in tone is especially the case considering, in the IGN interview mentioned earlier, Jeff Brown referred to the game as
more like the A-Team goes to World War II.
Which, again, I can get behind. Here's the issue with their approach, though. Each member of the A-Team had a distinct and memorable personality, something that can't really be said for the outfit. Here, it feels like there was only one regulation-issue personality shared between the three main characters. All three are given a sentence of backstory in the manual, but all of them essentially have the same mannerisms and speech patterns, and were expected to just assume that they have distinct personalities based on their appearances. It feels like a macho version of Team Girl Squad.
The meathead one! The black one! The pattern one!
Because of this, story beats that are supposed to be emotional, like Deuce being killed by the collaborator priest, just fall flat because there's no emotional investment leading up to it. It also doesn't help that Deuce's name feels like a poop joke, so having him killed off is dropping a deuce? Anyway, when Von Beck joins up with the outfit, that feels awkward too, because the cutscenes make it clear that Von Beck is only helping in exchange for their assistance in keeping him from execution. It doesn't exactly make him a relatable character, despite the fact that this is clearly what they were going for. The art designs for the main characters also aren't doing that relatability any favors. Again, while I get that they were going for a less serious tone, the weird cartoonish look here is disconcerting, but maybe that's just because of my experiences with a prior video. Let me explain. Back in the Small Soldiers video, we talked about how the Commando Elite were designed to critique militarism and war sold as entertainment to children. Part of that critique was the visual style of the toys, meant to evoke the Dirty Dozen characters that the voice actors in the film had played prior. Here, though, it feels like the devs looked at those Commando Elite designs and unironically went, "Those look great! A+, no notes!" Specifically, Mac bears an uncanny resemblance to Small Soldier's Brick Bazooka, while JD comes across as Butch Meathook. Deuce, on the other hand, just looks like a General Patton cosplayer. This lack of personality in design and dialogue is a shame because they got some strong voice talent for these main characters. Mac is voiced by Ron Perlman, which, I mean, it's a late 2000s video game. Perlman was pretty much obligated to show up somehow, right? JD is played by the original Kratos and the not original Mace Windu, T.C. Carson. And finally, Deuce Williams is voiced by the T-1000 himself, Robert Patrick. Fun fact, Patrick voiced Race Bannon in the 90s revival of Johnny Quest. You know, the one which took place equally in the real world and virtual reality? The 90s were a wild time. This lack of distinguishable personality among the main characters actually points at a greater issue with the game, and RTS games in general. The erasure of the individual. See, Alexander Galloway, in his book Gaming Essays on Algorithmic Culture, discusses how strategy games like the Civilization series or Age of Empires dehumanizes the people who comprise the player's armies and, well, civilizations. This is done because these individuals are reduced to homogeneous units, a basic set of identical stats used to balance gameplay, while also eliminating their individual value because each unit is replaceable and expendable. You can see this at work in the outfit as well. No outfit is made up of just three soldiers, and this one isn't either. However, the additional members are just units recruited from the Destruction on-demand menu. They are interchangeable, expendable, and all voiced by Nolan North. When one gets killed, it isn't a tragedy. Simply order another from the menu and he's airdropped in. This dehumanization explains why the hero characters aren't given much in the way of personality either. Sure, they are hero characters, but they are still just units in an RTS. The outfit attempts to bring together a number of unique ideas in order to stand out from the crowd of World War II games from the 2000s. Combining a third-person shooter with an RTS, while also trying to strike a significantly different tone from the other games on the market, sounds like a fantastic idea. While the attempt is admirable, these disparate ingredients never really come together as a cohesive whole, with half-baked mechanics, awkward level design, and writing that either feels rushed or unsure of itself. Despite this, there are enough interesting ideas on offer here to make for a good weekend rental.
The name's Bond. James Bond.